We are starting in exactly 2 minutes. You can go on and quickly call your friends in and say, we're going to start in 2 minutes. The timer is running already. Punctuality is very important. Eh?
Joyce's
Alright. Good evening. Yay. Come on, you can do better. Good evening, ECFC. Yeah. Come on, my friends, let's worship God today. As we lift the name of Jesus high. All creation shall rise and worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Thank you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Jesus. I'll invite Pastor Master and the guest to just open this evening with a word of prayer. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Let me just connect with each other by holding the person by the hand and maybe across the eyes if we can do it. We just like to invoke the blessing of the Lord tonight, because it's going to be His presence is going to minister to us as a family. Yes. Yes. Look how good and how pleasant it is when brothers live together in unity. It is like precious oil on the head descending to the beard, even to Aaron's beard, flowing down to the edge of his robes. It is like the dew of Hermon falling on Zion's mountains, for there the Lord commanded his blessing, life everlasting. Hallelujah. Father, we come to you. We would like to thank you for the work that trouble been done during this conference. We thank you that each one, we have all been blessed. But what has taken place, Father? And we believe that there's a lot more that you have in store for your people. So we come and we thank you that in this great gathering, we are a family. We may have come from all kinds of tribes, tongues, and nations. We thank you for the 28 or so nations represented, but we are a family. And as your family, we come together and declare that tonight you have prepared something for your people. And we declare that our hearts are open, our minds are open, our ears are open to hear what you want to say to your people, to speak to your people. And we pray, Lord God, that as you have anointed our worship, as you have anointed our songs, as we sing praises and worship to you, that you will keep this anointing flowing into our hearts, God. As your servant tonight will give us your anointed word, we with open hearts receive it tonight, Father, that you will minister so powerfully in our midst. God, thank you. There's a lot to expect even tonight. We give you praise and we give you glory in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Alright. You may be seated. Thank you, Pastor Mars. Thank you, worship team, for the tremendous worship this evening. Good evening, ECFC family. Are you out there? Are you having a good time? Oh yeah, just 10 people having a good time. Are you having a good time? Amen. Amen. He has no rival. He has no equal. Amen. Jesus has no rival, no equal. Now and forever He reigns. Amen. Hallelujah. This evening we are so blessed and so privileged. You know, every night, every session keeps getting better. Tonight we're going to be doing something really special. It's actually an ordination service for a missionary who has been working in Nepal for many, many years. How many years? 30 years or? Pardon? 90 years. Wow. 19 years. You know, I want to thank God for Dan. We've really been friends for many years. And tonight is his order. Yeah, go ahead, give the Lord a clap offering. I think many of you know Dan, his and Sharon, their family, the beautiful family, they're here tonight. And it's such a blessing because this is being done rightfully in his family here in ECFC. All right. And we are so blessed that Reverend Dr. Ted Vail and Reverend Dr. Jim Scott are here to do this ordination service. So without any further delay, I'd like to invite Reverend Dr. Ted Vail. Let's put our hands together.
Good evening. It was, I've been with Dan for a long time, but it was just not too long ago that I got to go to Nepal and witness something amazing. And I hope that everyone here, hopefully not at the same time, would go and visit. Because what you see is you see a nation being transformed. You see places where it's been very dark, and you see the light and coming. And now, the reason we wanted to do the ordination here is that a couple reasons. One, Dan can never make it back to his U.S. district conference because there's always something happening here. But I also know this, for them, yes, that's your district, but I think this is your home. And so because this is your home, you have many hundreds of children that call you mom and dad. But you have brought four of your daughters with you here. And so would you guys come on up here in front? We want to see all of you. And Jim, Leslie, would you come on as well? So you have Shanti, Charmi, Sushila, and Christy with you here. Isn't this a wonderful family?
I'm going to move the mic so that we can take better pictures.
Pastor Ramon from Nepal, yes, come to join us as well. So they are spiritual leaders. But here's what else they do. They provide education for children, vocational training and employment for women at risk, housing for the elderly and students, and they assist with medical camps, gospel media production, music skill training, and hosting worship classes and seminars. That's why I said you really do have to go and see this with your eyes, because God is doing a wonderful thing there. And I would just want to say on behalf of all of us how thankful and how proud we are of you. This is really our honor that we get to pray and have an ordination time for you, Dan. So, Pastor Jim, I'm going to hand it to you.
You all know that ordination is merely our recognition of what God has already done. God has already done something wonderful in Dan. We see it, we acknowledge it, and so we gather together as the Foursquare family. And what a unique experience to do it as a global Foursquare family. To lay hands on Dan, to pray for him, prophesy over him, through the ministry that he's already serving, we acknowledge, we see God's hand in his life, and that work, that great work that he's doing, we receive as part of our family. I've never, ever done an ordination with the global church. This is so amazing. And when Dan said he wanted to do it here, that you are his family, I could think of no better thing to say than yes, let's do it. Let's do it together as a global church, laying hands on one of our best. Wouldn't you agree that the Ingalls and their family are one of our best families serving you? Amen. So would you stand, and we've asked Pastor Leslie to lead us in the prayer. We're going to anoint with oil. We're going to pray. We're going to prophesy. I want to encourage you to pray out in your known or your unknown language. Fill this place with praise. We are doing battle today against spiritual forces in Nepal and all our nations. We are declaring Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord, and they will return to their nation with a new fire to continue to do the work they're doing. Amen? Amen? So let's pray together.
Father, we thank you and praise you for the honor, Lord, of recognizing ministry and ministers that do it. Lord, we pray in the name of Jesus for Pastor Dan and we are ordaining him in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And Lord, as we place our hands on him, Lord, we also thank you, Lord, for Cheryl, and we lay our hands on her because they serve you together. And also each of these children, Lord, who serve, Lord, serve you together, we just pray for them. And we anoint them, Lord, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. That your powerful anointing would rest upon them as they partner with their parents, Lord, to serve you. Oh, Father God, we just bless you. We thank you. And Lord, we thank you, Lord, for Ramon too, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for the family that they are. And as they serve together as family. So it's our joy to ordain them into the ministry and commission them back into Nepal to see signs and wonders and miracles and life transformations and city transformations and village transformations, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for the shepherds they are and the shepherd he is. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hallelujah.
wonderful. Amen. Dan's the real deal. Amen. Sometimes I mention Dan at home, I tell my wife, she said, which Dan? I said, Dan the man. She said, oh, okay. All right. Just very quickly, some announcements. What we're going to do, we got to have a photo session of this gathering. And Lemuel has, kind of figured out that maybe we'll have two sessions because some of us might be leaving tomorrow and some of us maybe later tomorrow night and early on Friday. So we're going to all arise and turn to the back. Okay, if you turn to the back now, let's all arise and turn to the back and then get to the middle. And then Lemuel will take it from there. Or everybody get to the center.
You can just stand where you are.
Stand where you are, okay.
And everyone, okay, the camera is going to be there. On top of the ladder. It's not there now, but it's going to be there. See with your eyes of faith. From the ladder to the end of that screen. So everyone here and outside, you guys come to the center. As well, the same place, same thing here. Anyone between the ladder and the end of the screen, please come to the front or squeeze in. So it's something like here. The living and the dead. Living and the dead. Alright, somewhere here. Thank you guys very much. You can also come to the front. Here is fine. All the way to the front is fine as well.
Can I stay on the stage?
Yes, you can. Okay, here is the same. Yes, Pastor Albert is the last one. The living and the dead. You're going to come to the front? There's more space.
Some of you can come and stand on the steps here so that you can be seen.
Yeah, you can also go to the back.
Come up on the steps and...
also go to the back.
Yeah.
Everyone come here.
So that you can be
Jifu,
seen.
Jifu, please help me. You're up.
You have a
move in or move to the back or to the front as well. You guys can move over there. The front is fine. The stage is fine as well. Okay, go to the stage. We're almost done. Here, guys. Pastor Albert is the last man. So, you're going to move over there. The stage is fine. You can also move to the back. Here, this side also?
No, left side can.
Stage, you can go to the stage as well.
I don't know how strong the stage is. Alright.
It's okay. It's okay.
I don't know whether
it's okay.
You can come up as Jerry is.
Yes, Jerry can do. After you come also. Welcome to the front. The front is okay as well. You don't have to sit or anything. You can stand or you can stand. Here. It's a few, but any of you, the two of you need to go somewhere, maybe to the over there. Thank you very much.
Back row can go on the chair if you want, like the Eagles. Back row.
Are we looking okay? The front is okay. Lots of space here. Right here is fine. I'm ready for my photo. Please take my photo. Here,
we need to squeeze and you can stay in the back. And front is fine too.
I can leave.
You need to move in a little bit more. Okay guys, 2 more minutes, we are done. Everyone in?
No?
Here, guys, you're holding up the photo shoot.
Sorry.
Sorry, and thank you. Sorry, and thank you.
No, you guys are fine, you guys are fine. No, I'm sorry. You need a position.
Okay.
Are we okay? Are we ready? I'm ready. That's all that counts, right?
This one's fine, but I come on.
How many? Three of them? Last three? Would you need me table? Is he in the picture in the front?
He's giving light over there.
Oh, you forgot to put film.
So please do sign up as soon as the meeting is over today. Please do not sign up now. After the meeting, you are free to sign up outside the ballroom. Sightseeing tour. The bus will leave at 1 o'clock, 1 p.m. All right. So those of us who are going, we need to finish lunch and be ready by 1 p.m. Group. There will be another group photography tomorrow night, which is with all our cultural costumes, all right? Just right in the middle of cultural night, we will be getting together and taking a picture with our cultural costumes. And of course, I believe that after that, you'll be taking lots of group photos yourself among your nations, with other nations, to remember this time together. And the next one is important. For those of you who have yet to pass your cultural night media, either your music or the song or anything that you need to be projected up on the screen, please see Osborne as soon as possible. Who is Osborne? Osborne, can you wave your hand? That's Osborne, the one who is doing the live streaming in the middle. All right, so please do pass your thumb drive to him as soon as possible so that he can compile whatever that is needed. Malaysian delegates, kindly stay back today after the meeting tonight and meet with Pastor Grace Khan. Pastor Grace, can you wait? Malaysian delegates, meet with Pastor Grace at the back of the hall today before you leave. She'll be at the door in case you try to escape. All right, and we will get together and discuss what we're going to be doing, planning to do tomorrow. The service tomorrow starts at 8 a.m. sharp. Can you tell your neighbor 8 a.m.? 8 a.m. Tell your neighbor 8 a.m. and then tell your the other side, don't go for seconds at 8 a.m. Right? 8 a.m. is the time to be here. Amen. Okay. And just to announce, there are resources, a lot of resources available at the back. Our t-shirts are selling really fast. We only have a few left. So for those of you who are waiting until tomorrow to buy a t-shirt, I have to say we are so sorry you might not get a t-shirt. So please see the book table at the back, Richard and Cynthia, see them and get your t-shirt, 30 ringgits per t-shirt after the service. There are also a lot of other materials here. There's an author from Singapore, Ricky Sim. Are you here, Ricky? Yeah, Ricky is right back, right here, and he's got three books that he's written on the heart and worship. So please feel free to pick up those books. It's a trilogy, three books. It's also available at the book table at the back. All right, so that's it. Before we have our speaker tonight, who is Reverend Joyce Butron, none other than our area missionary for Southeast Asia. We will have a wonderful husband, Prince Philip, Pastor George Butron, come and share with us about the Global Prayer Initiative. All right, let's welcome George.
When my wife became my boss a little while ago, nothing changed. It's all the same, the same way it's always been. Because men, when you get married, no matter how many times you change jobs, you will always have the same boss. Remember that. Yeah. The Foursquare Global Council is one of the most off the radar things that is happening in our movement today, but it is one of the most powerful. And the Global Council has brought together global leaders of nations and regions to catalyze vision, to strategize how to do evangelism, to mobilize us in reaching the world. And there has been many, many prayer initiatives over the past several years. Pastor Glenn has launched the 21 days of prayer and fasting that takes place every year in January. And so many of us around the world have been joining in that. There is a prayer app that has been launched by the U.S. Church that brings updates and prayer requests. And some of us have that app on our phones. But when Pastor Leslie stepped into this role, he came with a very, very clear vision and passion to even increase the level of prayer and the connection of prayer throughout our global family. He told me that he has hundreds of personal intercessors that pray for him constantly in the nation of Sri Lanka and in other places. And he wants everyone to have the experience of constant intercession. When the Bible talks about day and night, that is the Bible's way of saying 24/7. Unceasing, continuous prayer. And in the world today, there are growing prayer movements, and there are more people praying, more people connected in prayer than at any other time in human history. There are more prayer initiatives and prayer movements than have ever existed before. The Global Council is wanting to find a way to create 24/7, 365 prayer around the world. A way for us to join the global prayer movement, not to be off in a corner by ourselves, but to get into this mighty river, this stream of intercession that God is raising up in the nations today, because that is the way the nations will change. We're looking for a way for every local church to become a house of prayer, a way for us to pursue our calling because we have a global vision, and a way for us to strengthen our identity because we have distinctives that make us a family as Foursquare. And so I'm very pleased to announce to you tonight that we are the region that is launching the Foursquare Global Prayer Network. We are coming together as a church family, and we've been looking for the right way to do this. We've been asking the question, what would be the most effective way? I have a nephew who spent 15 years as an intercessory missionary at the International House of Prayer in Kansas City. I've been to that great ministry, and I've been moved and rocked by what I've seen there, but it's not reproducible in all of our churches. I have, we were impacted in Singapore recently by a movement out of East Africa called Building Prayer Altars. And it's a tremendous prayer movement that is gaining traction in many nations, but it's not always reproducible and sustainable in the local church. On this past Sunday night, on the 7th of October, I gathered with 50,000 believers in the nation of Singapore in our national stadium, the Sports Hub, for 3 hours of prayer and intercession for our nation. And believers from all denominations and churches came together, 50,000 strong, and we prayed and we asked God for a revival. But let me tell you something about that meeting. As powerful and as dynamic and as wonderful as it was,
It cost over $1 million to rent the sports hub. And 50,000 people is 1/20th of the Christian population in Singapore. So 1/20th of the believers were able to come together for one night to pray for 3 hours. And it was powerful and dynamic, and I know heaven was moved by what happened. But we're looking for a way for every local church, every believer, to be activated and mobilized in prayer, because we all know that we want our churches to be praying churches. We may have differences in doctrinal positions and priorities, but we all have to share the same priority for prayer. And so we have found a model. We have found an approach that we think will work for big churches, small churches, for churches in restricted access countries, and for churches where there's great freedom and liberty. And it is a 24/7 prayer model that works with the local pastor, through the local pastor, and mobilizes the local church. We all want to ask that the brochures be passed out at this time. We have a brochure enough for every one of you to have one. They're small size, and we can quickly distribute those. I'm going to explain what we're seeking to do. First of all, we have a vision to unite and equip a global prayer force of 100,000 four-square churches around the world for spiritual awakening. We're partnering with other networks to mobilize 5 million churches around the world. This is going to bring together many, many prayer movements to mobilize 5 million churches in 24/7 prayer for worldwide revival and kingdom breakthrough. We feel that there's a call for us to devote ourselves and pray for our communities and our nations and our local churches. We want every pastor to be able to set an agenda of prayer for his or her local church. We also want to be able to add to that agenda larger priorities and areas of focus within regions and nations. And when there are emergencies and disasters and unforeseen situations that arise, we want to have a way to instantly mobilize prayer around the world. We believe that every church, regardless of size, program, budget, situation, can adopt either a day or a half day of prayer every month. And this is the way to build a culture for kingdom breakthrough. So that's what we're after. That's what we're going about. And here's the plan. Here's how it works. Every church adopts a monthly day or half day of prayer. And they fill those 12 or 24-hour segments with prayer. People in the congregation sign up. The taxi driver, the construction worker, the teacher, the mom, the family that wants to do it together as a family. They choose their time slot. And they set aside that time during that day every month, and they pray. They're provided with a few prayer pointers, and then they pray, and they bring the request to God. Churches may call for a prayer meeting on that day. They might meet for 2 or 3 hours, but the rest of the time, people will pray from home. They'll pray from work. They'll pray from their schools. They'll pray at night during the night watches. Pastors could appoint a prayer coordinator. Because our schedules are so busy, maybe we want to have a prayer coordinator who would help to mobilize and organize and make sure all the slots are filled. And then every month, every pastor will have the privilege of standing in front of his church or her church and saying, last month we prayed, and here's what happened. And this week is our day of prayer, and we still have a few slots to fill, so I'm going to ask you to sign up, and we're going to go for it. We're going to storm heaven, and we're going to see God answer. We're going to see great breakthrough. This is what we're proposing, and it's very simple, and it's very doable. We hope that as more and more churches mobilize to join this prayer movement, that every nation will be able to appoint a prayer coordinator, or perhaps regional prayer coordinators. Those prayer coordinators will receive an update every month, giving some guidance and direction on how to pray. Those prayer coordinators will also receive emergency prayer requests. Those will then be sent out to the prayer coordinators in the local churches. So we will have quick, fast, seamless mobilization for prayer. Why do we want to do this? A few minutes ago, as we prayed for the Ingalls, we experienced the power of united prayer. We weren't just praying for this family. We were praying for breakthrough in a nation that has ancient strongholds. And we know that those strongholds are not going to be moved by programs. They're not going to be moved by just one or two ministries. They're going to be moved by the Christ of God's people. We have the opportunity to join Jesus in what he does every moment of every day. As he intercedes before the throne of the Father, we can join him in his great ministry. When Paul the Apostle told the church at Thessalonica, pray without ceasing, it was not a command for personal prayer. Pray when I get up, pray when I brush my teeth, pray when I put on my shoes, pray before I eat breakfast, pray after I eat breakfast, pray on the way. No, the church at Thessalonica didn't understand it in that way. They thought the church over here can take this day, and the church down the valley can take that day, and the church in this part of the city can take another day. And in that way, we can pray without ceasing. I believe this is the call upon our movement. I believe we're facing challenges in nations that are only going to move when we're on our knees crying out to God. Story of the widow, persistent widow in Luke 18. Very interesting conclusion to that story as she persisted and bothered that judge and pestered him until he gave her an answer. And it says, he will not God give justice. We have huge need for justice in the world today. And it's the prayers and the intercession of God's people that are going to release justice into the nations. We've seen it happen. We've seen God respond to our cries and our prayers. We've seen huge shifts taking place in nations. It's got to continue and it's got to increase. And so I am inviting you tonight to do one simple thing, to, as a pastor, as a leader. We don't want to bypass you, pastors. We want you fully on board. We know if we have you, we have your congregations too. And so, pastors, would you consider this? Would you pray about this? Maybe you're ready to say, I'm in right now. Would you join us in mobilizing a prayer movement that is very quickly going to spread to the other regions of the world? And I believe we'll have 100,000 four-square churches at prayer every single day, every moment of every day. And I believe we're going to see incredible change take place as a result. I'd like to ask you to stand. And I'm so glad to have these few moments to share this with you and to feel the rising passion that we all have, to see the nations moved and changed, and to see the nations won for His great name. Back in the 1700s, a wealthy, aristocratic young man named Nicholas von Zinzendorf gave up his inheritance and moved to the family estate in Herndon, Germany, and began a movement that transformed the world. For 100 years, every hour of every day, teams of two manned a prayer room. And it was a 100-year prayer meeting that was ceaseless. And as a result of that prayer meeting, a missions movement was launched. And that movement changed nations. People gave themselves to the work of God and the Great Commission like never before. People sold themselves into slavery to go and reach the slaves in the Caribbean. And the cry of that movement was, may the lamb that was slain receive the rewards of his sufferings. I believe our prayers, our intercessions will launch such a movement today. Would you join me? Can we pray? Can we ask God to pour out the spirit of grace and intercession upon our movement? Could we ask God to light a fire that will not be extinguished? Please join me. Let's pray. Father, we call upon you tonight and we thank you, O God, that you hear the cries of your people and that, God, you send justice. And you open heaven, and you come down, O God, in response to our cries. And Lord, tonight we join you in your ceaseless ministry before the throne. We call upon you, Jesus, now to raise up among us, Lord, constant points of light, candles, flames burning around the nations, O God, that would bring your kingdom, your reign, your rule, and your breakthrough into the world. Oh God, light a flame in our hearts tonight that will not be extinguished. We call upon you now, Father. We believe you, O God, for the deepest transformations, the greatest revivals, the mightiest spiritual breakthroughs in the history of the world. Father, as we, your people, humble ourselves and pray, turn from our wicked ways and call upon your name. Thank you, O God, for what you're about to do. Thank you, O God, in advance for the breakthroughs and the advance of your kingdom. We call upon you tonight. We thank you and we praise you in the mighty name of Jesus. And let's say it three times. We're going to say amen, amen, amen. Ready? Amen, amen, amen.
Wasn't that, George, wasn't that amazing? Such an anointing that I sense. And Let's pray for George, okay? Please. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for this great gift that you have given us. Thank you, Lord, for the hours that he has put into this work. Lord, we were able to sit and hear him, Lord, but all the hours of work, tears and prayers that went, Lord, into producing this. We thank you, Lord, for the wisdom and grace and the gift that George is to us. And Lord, today we launch him as the global prayer coordinator of the Four Square Gospel Church International. Lord, we pray in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit that he would be blessed and preserved and protected and anointed by the power of God. Use him, Lord. Use him, Lord. Lord, every letter he writes, every plea he makes, Lord, every challenge he does, Lord, it will be anointed by the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, like you put Goliath down by one stone, Lord, every time he raises his voice, Lord, to call upon people to pray, it will be like David putting Goliath down by the power of the Holy Spirit. Anoint him, Lord. We pray your blessing upon him in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you very much.
Just a very quick announcement. The Southeast Asia Women's Leaders Meeting is right after lunch tomorrow inside the dining room. Please see Sister Sally Chavez, the Southeast Asia Women's Bank. Can you stand, Sister Sally? So they can, most of them know who you are. Right? So ladies, please see Sister Sally Chavez after lunch tomorrow. All right, without any further ado, I know Joyce is a great word for us, so let's put our hands together and welcome Reverend Joyce Buchla.
We get to claim him. Maybe that's selfish. get to claim them. I don't know if that's selfish or not. The launch of our prayer initiative. Now, you know, I sometimes feel a little bit apologetic because, like, you heard my husband, right? You know, yeah, let's get out there, we're going to do this. That's not me. so you're not getting that. Just thought I'd tell you that. But we got to have the launch of our global prayer network, which truly is the way that we're going to see our nations and our world change for Jesus Christ. He says it differently. I have the same passion. I just don't say it that way. But there's one other thing that we need to celebrate. And if we could have Ted Olbrich stand up, today is his 72nd birthday. And if there is someone in the house who can sing or lead us in singing, I'd like us to just sing happy birthday to him, and I will not leave that. That is a blessing and a gift to all of you. Maybe Dan, would you, he's back, all the way back there, he's doing translation, so now he's not, but Dan, would you be willing to lead us?
Sure. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
I want to tell you that on the back table, I request requested for us, and Shane and Rachel very kindly carried them in their suitcase. Foursquare Identity Keystones. And I have found that, I mean, it's a tiny little book. It is free. It is for you to take and read. But it just reminds us of who God has called us to be as a family. What are the distinctives that set us apart from some other denominations? And why is it that the rest of the body of Christ needs us just as much as we need them? And so I want to encourage you, please pick one up at the back table and read it. And let God speak to you through the way he has spoken to me. I do have one other confession. I was reading the name tag, which I took off because it keeps getting in the way. But I saw my topic last night. I did. Now I have to confess, that's not the topic I thought I'd been assigned. Yes, it's true. And the worst part is I proofread that paper and didn't catch that it didn't match what was in my personal notes. Sorry. You don't know what you're getting, but there it is. I'm done with all my confessions. I think we're good now. I now have a question for all of you, okay? We're going to see how this is. If you were released into some kind of ministry or position of responsibility or authority before the age of 30 that you did not think you were prepared for, could you please stand up? So, a position of ministry, a responsibility, or a job you did not think you were prepared for, and you were given this responsibility before you turned 30. Okay, look around at each other. You guys are a pretty nice looking group. Now, as you sit down, I want you to think about the person who was brave enough, or foolish enough, to release you. Because we want to talk about what it means to prayerfully release cutting-edge leaders. I was not, the word cutting-edge was not in my mind. I really thought I was supposed to be doing how do we prayerfully release emerging or new leaders, and I just had a whole different idea in my head. So there we are. If you were older than 30 when you got launched into some kind of responsibility that you felt was bigger than you, that doesn't invalidate that. It just means you were a little bit older. That's okay. There's nothing wrong with that. Someone had to be willing to take a chance on an untried and unproven leader at some point. And all of us were that at one point in time. We didn't necessarily have the skills that we needed. We did not necessarily have the resources that we needed, but somebody said, well, let's let them try. And we were able to do that. You need to begin praying for the leaders that you need and you want before you need and want them. If you aren't praying today for what you're going to need in 5 or 6 years, you better get started. And we have this great global prayer initiative that will help you, okay? But we need to begin praying out for what we want in the future, so that God will be able to help us to identify the people that he wants us to be strategically engaged in helping them become the men and women that God wants them to be, so that they will be positioned to divinely fulfill the purpose and calling that God has given to them, and to recognize that God does have a purpose for every one of us, and it may not be what we think it's going to be. It may look very different. I also just want you to know, you guys should be really happy they gave me a microphone that I have to hold, because my husband says I talk with my hands, and then when I talk with my hands, I talk faster. So they're helping us have better control here. When we think about cutting-edge leaders, the first thing we have to do is we have to identify the who. Who is it that God wants you to be investing your time and your energy in? I got to be in a couple of workshops, and one of them I only got to be a part of, but in both of the workshops I was in, I really was, and then Pastor Glenn this morning was like, you guys are taking my notes. That's not fair. They were talking about releasing leaders. They're talking about engaging people. They're talking about living life with people so that you begin to have a relationship that changes and transforms not just their lives, but your life as well. And so I thought, well, maybe I'm headed in the right direction. But we need to be able and willing to allow people to see our lives. For Sally Chavez to actually answer her iPhone with put the video on at 6:30 in the morning when she hasn't yet finished getting her hair combed to talk to me. You gotta be pretty secure and say, yep, it's okay, it's just Joyce, she can live with it. But to be able to live life, whether it's really, really good and it looks nice on the outside or it's really, really messy and it's just a disaster. We need to be willing to let people see us when we are both at our best and at our worst. We need to be willing to hang out and eat meals and scrub floors and clean toilets and change diapers or whatever it is that the people that God is calling us to mentor are engaged in doing at this point in time. We need to be asking them questions that allow us to discover who they are and what passions God has placed within their life. And we need to recognize that we, as we identify them, that there are some things that we will have to have done with prayer. When we think about some well-known Bible passages, I think of Jesse's boys. And we have this example in 1 Samuel, right? Sam has got this job. Go find the new king. Anoint the new king. Don't get killed. Find the new king. Yeah, so he's got this job. He's got this, right? He's off on this. And he shows up at Jesse's place. And, you know, he walks in and is like, oh, yeah, that one looks good. And God says no. And he goes, well, that one looks good. No. So he goes through this process of listening to the voice of the Lord so that he can identify who is this person supposed to be. And so in 1 Samuel chapter 16, we see that elimination process. And he finally gets to David. And God says, yes, there, that's the one. Anoint him. And we see him later begin to continue to have a relationship with David. But he begins by hearing God's voice and identifying who it is that he's supposed to anoint. Who is it he's supposed to be investing in? And when he anoints him as king, remember, he is investing a lot of himself. Because if Saul finds out, he could get dead really quick. Okay? So we need to identify and then recognize the potential of those people. Some of the things we need to consider as we look at mentoring options is we need to ask ourselves the question, how do we deal with people that are maybe, in our minds, too old or too young, or they're not the gender we thought they should be? Okay, and we had our great workshop that helped us recognize, you know, those issues. What I mean is, we might sometimes think, oh, I'm only supposed to mentor a woman, or I'm only supposed to mentor a man, but you know what? God has called us to actually mentor and minister to the whole body of Christ. But when we do that, we have to be wise. Maybe we have a group of 3 or 4 or 5, and it's some young men and some young women, and we're ministering to both of those groups, both of those genders of people. So we need to ask about that. And then the other thing that we need to recognize is that when God calls us to mentor people, he doesn't call us to mentor people who are just like us. He's not asking us to make a bunch of little clones. We don't need 900 little George clones or little Dan clones. Now, it would be really nice to have them if they all keep working as well as these two gentlemen I mentioned are. But God's not calling us to make clones. He's calling us to make disciples who follow him and look like him, not like us. And so when we think about that, we need to be willing to work with a diverse group of people. And when you have a small group and they're different from each other, they stretch us. They cause us to grow. They strengthen us in ways that wouldn't happen otherwise, but they also drive us slightly crazy. I mean, seriously, I like to follow rules. In case you guys haven't noticed, I like to follow rules. Rules are good things. They help us function well. Time schedules are wonderful things. They help us function well. But I have a lot of brothers and sisters that think, time? We got a lot of time. The rule was made to be bent. What do you think? That's why they had it, so we could bend it. So we need them, and sometimes it does drive me a little crazy. But it's a good kind of crazy, because I need to be stretched. I need to be changed. I need to continue to become the woman that God wants me to be. We need to not make assumptions about the people that we're mentoring, the people that God is calling us to walk with. If you only mentor to create pastors, or you only mentor to create janitors, you only mentor to do whatever that thing is in your mind, you are going to miss the wonderful privilege of walking in relationship with people as they discover who God has called them to be and what he has called them to do. And so we don't want to do that. We don't want to miss that. We want to validate the calling that God has put on their lives. And can I speak to you as a bunch of ministers? There's a lot of us here that are ministers, right? God has not called everybody into the clergy. He has called the majority of people into the marketplace. And our job is to equip them so that they can go and be ministers in the marketplace. It's our job to help them be the men and women that God has called them to be so that they can go where God has destined them to go and they can transform the world that they are in every single day. So don't make assumptions and recognize that the marketplace ministry is a real and valid and significant place of ministry, and we need people that love Jesus in those places. We also need to consider the when. We need to consider the when. We need to know prayerfully, when do you release people into ministry? I can remember Leland Edwards saying, if you release them too soon, it's in the dirt, right? And if you release them too late, it's over their head. That's the, I don't know baseball real well, but it's something like that. It's all in the timing. When do you throw that pitch that allows the person to hit it out of the park? But we have to have that. So we need to know when it is important to release people. We also have to consider and recognize the fact that new leaders will not be perfect. And in case you haven't noticed, you're not perfect either. Oh wait, I didn't really say that, did I? Never mind, I didn't say that. You are all perfect, I am not. We'll just leave it at that, okay? But if we think about 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 26 through 30, it says, brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. It is because of him that you and I are in Christ, who has become for us wisdom from God. That is our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. Remember where you came from. But don't let the baggage of the past sabotage the future. John Mark is a wonderful example of this for us in Scripture. In Acts 13:13, what does he do? He bails on his job. The assignment is, be here, and he's gone. He leaves his position. Then you get to Acts 15, starting verse 38, and what happens? There's a huge fight between Paul and Barnabas, right? Let's take John Mark. Oh, there is no way that guy's ever going with me again. Right? We hear the tension there. And it is such a hard moment that what do we have? We have a split. The leadership team is divided. Don't you guys want to really start releasing cutting-edge leaders? We get to have division. Oh, wait. Yeah, we get division. Sometimes we really do have division as we release people. We see God doing something that, from our earthly perspective, is like, what in the world is going on? This was supposed to be a good thing, and now it looks like total chaos and destruction. But then we get to 1 Timothy, and what do we see? I'm sorry, 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy chapter 4, we discover that there's reconciliation. And now Paul values who John Mark is and what he is able to do in advancing the kingdom of God. So yes, it's messy sometimes. It's painful at times. But we still need to release people at the right time, even when to our earthly perspective or our human perspective, it doesn't seem like the right moment. We have to be willing to do this. There will be lots of messes, but messes can be cleaned up, right? We've all done that with little children. Messes can be cleaned up. And these messes often become the foundation for future growth and the potential for a future message. People took a risk with me. I'd like to mention some of them by name, but I won't because I don't want Jim Scott to tell me that I'm still not practicing some submission, so that I'm just learning how to be submitted. I don't want to go there with him, but I won't mention people by name. People took a risk with me. My first Sunday school director set me loose with a flannel graph and a bunch of kids. Yes, some of you remember those flannel graphs. I had a pastor that said to me, so you want to start a prayer meeting for a bunch of teens? Sure. And then I very kindly invited him and the other adult sponsors to stay in a different room while we prayed. But out of that prayer meeting, what happened is we had people filled with the Holy Spirit. We had people begin to speak in we were together and it was our peers, we were able to do something that we might not have been able to do otherwise. But they loved me through it and they allowed me to do it. I also had a teacher, now you're gonna like this, I had a teacher in high school. I don't know how I convinced him of this. He was not a believer. And I convinced him that he wanted to sponsor our Bible club that met at 7:10 in the morning on Tuesdays so that we could have a time to get together and pray and study our Bible before school started. He had no idea what he was getting himself into because as we began to pray and study, more students became involved. We had people getting delivered. We had people getting filled with the Holy Spirit. We had people getting saved. And it became a really wild party on Tuesday mornings in the bathroom. And he had no clue what was waiting for him, but he managed to survive that. I think he did. I never did ask him how he felt about it when all was said and done. That's probably bad on my part. But if we're going to develop cutting-edge leaders, we've got to be willing to take a chance on people. We've got to be willing to let them make mistakes. We need to be willing to let them mess up, but we also need to let them try innovative things. Things that maybe we tried and didn't work, but now they're going to try it, and the timing is different, and they work. Sometimes we are tempted to mentor in ways that are not always the most helpful and productive for the body of Christ. And I'm going to go very quickly. I want to talk about some ways that we sometimes try to mentor or choose to mentor, and then look at maybe a better way to do that. Sometimes we mentor towards happiness. And if you're mentoring so that people are going to be happy, yay, everybody's smiling, it's a party. You become a party planner. You're my best friend. You're superheroes. You take care of everything. That's the role you have to assume as the mentor. Well, these may sound like some really good things and a lot of fun, but they do not create a good foundation for growth and development because the person is never being challenged to stretch and grow beyond. When we prioritize happiness, we don't let the ones we mentor fail. And we all know that some of our best growth happens when we fail. We remove the consequences of the choices and actions and the decisions that they make. And we all know that consequences are things that help us to figure out what is right and what is wrong, what is true and what is false. We won't let them struggle or fight, but sometimes if you think about when a butterfly comes out of its cocoon, if it doesn't fight to get out, it never learns to fly. And so we have to have a place where they learn to struggle and they learn to fight. We give them what they should earn. There are some times when you really do have to earn a privilege or you have to earn a place of responsibility that's not your norm. And so if we don't do that to them, we cheat them of the thing that God wants them to learn and to know and to value because they've earned it. We value removing all pain. And although we know that pain is not fun, pain is a part of life. And so we're setting them up for future failure because they don't know how to deal with the reality of life and to learn to recognize that Jesus Christ walks with us through our pain. He walks with us in every circumstance and situation. And so if we're prioritizing happiness, these are some of the things that happen. When we prioritize happiness as our reason for mentoring, what we do for the ones we mentor is what they should learn to do for themselves. And we really have to allow them to do that. Another tendency that we often have is to mentor towards performance. And I've lived in Asia for most of the last 30 years, so I'm going to speak with a tiny, tiny bit of experience in this area. As Asians, we often mentor and we prioritize on performance. And what we do is when we're looking at that, we become the policeman, become the coach, we become the judge of everything that the person or the people that we're mentoring are doing, what they're saying, how they're behaving. And when we prioritize performance, we hold people to a high and often unrealistic expectation. We get overly angry when they don't measure up. Our praise becomes dependent on their performance. Fear becomes our primary motivator. And unfortunately, in our Asian context, because of the value of face, we often mentor and guide people, whether it's mentees, whether it's people, our colleagues, with this whole idea of performance. And we're moving them in a way that does not help them. I'm not suggesting that we don't strive for excellence, but it's the motivation that guides the excellence. What is it that's driving us towards that excellence? When we prioritize performance, we unwittingly teach the ones we are mentoring that our love and our acceptance are conditional. We see the ones we are mentoring and their success as a reflection of our own success. We may feel that we gain or lose face based on how they perform and what they do. And we forget that they are called into a relationship with Jesus Christ first. And it's a hard thing. I remember as a mom, sometimes being terribly embarrassed and feeling like, oh no, what should I do? When my children would misbehave. You know, it's like, oh no, that's my child, but I really have to go claim them, okay? Have you ever been there? Maybe I'm the only one. And it's because we're valuing them based on their performance. We're not valuing them because they've been created in the image of God. We're not valuing them because they are valuable just because they are. They don't have to do anything because God has said they're valuable. But I believe what we are really called to is that we're to mentor toward the heart. And when you mentor towards the heart, your role is that of a pastor, a shepherd, and a steward. You learn to care for people, to comfort them, to come alongside, to listen, to just be present in those moments with them. When we prioritize the heart, we focus on desires, not just actions. Sometimes you might have someone that what they do is like, what in the world were they thinking? But as soon as you find out what was in their heart, it's like, they were trying so hard to be so kind or thoughtful, or the list goes on. And the actions and the motive of the heart didn't necessarily line up. It's like my grandson running to go get the cup of water and on the way back spilling it all over the floor. The motivation was, I want to serve mommy and get her the water. The action was not quite so there yet. So what do? Do you go, what did you do? You spilled the book, or do you, here's some paper towel, wipe it up. Let's clean up the mess. When we mentor from the heart, we value honesty and transparency. We make our relationships safe relationships where people have the ability to tell us anything. Whether that thing is something really horrible in our eyes and not so bad in theirs, or something that's horrible in their eyes and we just say, really, that's bothering you? But we create a safe environment where they can actually talk about those things that are deep in their heart. We openly admit when we're wrong. Now, my husband will tell you that in every relationship, there is one person who more easily apologizes and admits they're wrong than others. And he would, if you ask him, he would sheepishly confess that yes, his wife is not that person. Have you ever seen a little child having a temper tantrum and being dragged along the floor by their mother or her father? That is a picture of me and God when I am wrong and I do not want to apologize. I've gotten a little better. We've been married 37 years. I think I've apologized twice. I'm getting there. Okay, maybe three times. But we openly admit when we're wrong. And that is something that in our culture sometimes that is so hard. It is so challenging. It is something that it's like, if I do that, I will no longer have a position in anybody's life. But the reality is that when we do that, we open up the doors for other people to say, you know, I really messed up too. Would you forgive me? And so we need to do that. We need to value transformation, not perfection. Because the reality is that we will never be perfect. We will never do everything perfectly. But we can be transformed little by little, day by day, into the man or the woman that God has called us to be. And when we prioritize the heart, then love becomes our motivator. We're not doing it because it's going to do something for me. We're not doing it because it's going to look good on prioritize the heart, our primary job is not simply mentoring new leaders, but rather introducing the ones we mentor to a real relationship with Jesus. That relationship will then result in their ability to become the one he has purposed them to be. In order to do that, we have to be willing to give our ministry away. I want to tell you a story. I taught school for many years, and I used to watch my students. And sometimes I would see a student, and it was like, they didn't want to come to class, they were not paying attention, they were never doing their homework. Things were just not good with them. And one year I had a group of ninth grade boys, and life was not good with them. And they were not doing well in my class, and that really bothered me, because remember, I like rules. So they were not doing well, and I was talking to them, I was listening to them. We were at lunch, and I was at lunch with the students in the canteen, and so they started talking. I said, so what do you guys really like to do? What do you do when you're, after school, when you're hanging out, what do you do? And turned out they all like football. Now for you, those of you who are not from here, football is soccer, okay? They like football. And so we're talking, and they're telling me, yeah, it's too bad our school doesn't have a team. They all say that is basketball and track. Who wants basketball when you can have soccer? Why would you want to use your hands when you can use your feet? And so I listened to this. And so went on a couple days later. I was still thinking about these students that are just not doing well. And I thought, but they love soccer. They love football. So what can I do? Now, guys, I am not a story person, just a hint. But I decided we needed a soccer team. So I started a soccer team. I do not play soccer. But there is the internet, and it gives you ways to teach people to do those drills and run those games. And I knew a couple of people that play soccer. And I thought, I'll invite them to come and help me coach. Right. Got permission, got the parents to sign off, yes, my child. And I had an ulterior motive, okay guys, really, I did. In order to be on the soccer team, they had to have at least a C average in every class. And it was like, I can get them to pass my class, we'll have a football team, we'll buy uniforms. I contacted schools, I set up matches. Do you know, I don't know anything about any of this stuff. It's like, we're gonna play for how many minutes? Okay, sure. We need how many people? We show up these games. I've got my 10 guys. Well, you need 11. I've got my 10 guys, and they stand up, and the other team comes on the field, and their smallest player is twice the size of my largest player. And you're like, oh, thank you, Jesus, this is gonna be fun. We lost every single match. We did score one goal all season. They passed their classes. They all passed their classes that year. We scored one goal, they all passed their classes. I felt like I had a win. They weren't quite so much there. This whole time I've been praying, please God, I am not a soccer player. Football is, I like to watch it. I like the World Cup, guys. I enjoy those things. That's not what I do. I trip over my own 2 feet. I don't play football. But I was praying, and you say, God, next year I will coach the team. I will set up the matches. I will be after school for hours with these boys out in the hot sun while they run around on the field and I pretend that I know what I'm telling them to do. But could you please bring someone that really does know what they're doing to the school? School gets out, it's now July, and I'm at the school meeting the new staff. We're having all this conversation and about an hour into the morning and all of our in-service training, this very tall, young, brand new teacher walks up beside me and he says, are you the one that has the football team? And I'm like, yeah. And he's like, could I help? And I said, well, I don't know. You're welcome to, but yeah, I mean, have you ever played? He goes, oh yeah, I played all through college. And I'm like, would you like to have the team? Let me give it to you. And he looked at me and he said, you would give me your team? And I said, I would give you my team and here's the uniforms. When do you want to start practice? I was praying for someone to come along and take this over. If you are praying for God to bring you what you need, he will. And they may be young, They may have no experience as a teacher, but they're passionate about the thing that God has called you to have someone to be passionate about. And I have to say, Sam Fleischman changed the lives of many, many young men at our school because he was willing to coach them. He was willing to have them hang out in his room and hang out in his home. And he helped these young men that we were losing. We were losing them spiritually, we were losing them emotionally, academically, and yet he was able to connect with them and help bring them back in, because somebody who didn't play football and had no skills in that area said, I can start a football team and trust that God will bring the right leader at the right time to step into that place. When we mentor, when we come alongside people from our heart, we will see a significant difference in the way that we release leaders. We will see a significant difference in the way that they are able to function and love and care for others when we take those stigmas away. I'm going to ask Pastor Leslie to come up. I really believe that God wants each of us to reconsider the way that we've been mentoring, the way that we've been asking for those new leaders. Have we been looking at just performance? Have we been thinking that we just need to make everybody happy? If everybody's happy, then they'll come and they'll serve. Have we been looking at it saying, I need to get my stuff done, rather than looking at it saying, I need to position myself so that God can get this stuff done in the lives of each of the people that he brings into my life to have input in? So Pastor Leslie, who would come and just lead us in prayer?
Many of us here need a real touch of the Lord desperately. God spoke to you when George spoke, and he spoke to you when Joyce spoke. And even before you came here, you came with some sense of urgency in your heart to be touched, quickened, to be filled, to be released, and if I may say, to be delivered from some addiction that you have, and perhaps no one knows about it. There's something that you keep tripping all the time over. And some of you here are heartbroken, feeling defeated. No matter what you try, things began to fail. And sometimes it stood for a little while, but then it went down the drain almost. And you know that you know that you know that you need a touch of the Holy Spirit upon your lives. It will be actually a wasted opportunity if we move on into our rooms right now and don't do anything about it. I feel and sense the Holy Spirit wants to touch us. He wants to move upon our lives in a very powerful way tonight. Some of you need healing, physical healing. Some of you need healing in your mind. Some of you have reconciliation challenges. Some of you know that you need a desperate transformation, a transforming touch of the Holy Spirit. Family, we are here because we are all in need. We are here because we want to worship him fully and not half-bound. We want to, we came here that we might be freed up to go back. Set on fire for the Lord Jesus. Let's press in tonight, shall we? Let's press in tonight. And allow the Spirit of the living God to touch you and minister to you. Whatever your need is, whatever your challenge is, whatever your addiction is, whatever is the purpose of your heart to come here. I would like for you, I give this opportunity for you to come and receive prayer. Just come and allow the Holy Spirit to touch you. And I also would like to ask some of the senior leaders, the senior pastors. You don't need to be a national leader, but senior pastors. You know in your heart that the Lord brought you here to minister to people. So those who need a touch, would you please come? And those of us who would like to minister, maybe, you know, the Lord would give you a prophetic word. Maybe the Lord would give you a word of knowledge as you pray for people, for freedom and healing. This is a wonderful, this is a powerful moment. God is an opportunity God is giving us to experience the power of the living God. You heard two powerful messages from people who have gone through such marvelous experiences. Their lives encourage us to come and move forward. Please come and receive this touch of the Lord. We invite you to come. Don't want to coax anyone, but we want to give you this invitation, lovingly, graciously to come and receive. If you sense a lack, just come. Those of you who need, who know the Lord brought you here to minister to people, please come right now and touch these dear ones. You see their hearts and you see within them tears and brokenness. Please come. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know the Lord wants, the Lord's wanting to anoint you and empower you, release you. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Come. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, come. Receive the touch of God. Receive the touch of the Holy Spirit. Come in the name of the Lord. Receive the touch of Jesus. Don't go sick. Go back healed. Don't go discouraged. Go back encouraged. Don't go wanting to give up. But go wanting, knowing that the Lord has brought you here from victory. I would like for the pastors to come and minister as well. Leaders and pastors, would you please come? And take this opportunity to minister to these ones who need a touch of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Some of you come with challenges of ministry and family, and you don't know how to go back into the same place where you came. Come and receive a touch of God. Let the Holy Spirit minister to you tonight in a very powerful way. Father, we thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, the Spirit of God is here right now. Come here to minister to the grace of the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. As we pray, keep coming. As we pray, keep coming. Keep
one first, someone out of one way first.
Over the past month or so, she has a word to come into the release of words. Masu, are you here? Come.
Fill it up.
our family here tonight. It's really fun to be here.
Well, this is the first time I've ever done or experienced anything like this. This is really cool for me. But I'm just seeing this picture of Christ in the center on the cross. And we're all beside him on our own crosses. And he looks to us and he says, "You don't have to, because I already did. And I did it once for all. There's no need for you to live every day in chains, because I broke them off when I shed my blood one time for everyone forever." So I just feel like there are people just living without this ability to go forward because there's still a shackle. There's still a cross. And they're still on a cross for what they've already been saved from. So I just am seeing this picture of letting go of the nails that hold you to that cross, because Christ already has the holes in his hand. We don't have to.
And that world lives in our homes, and they're in our families, and they're people that we do business with every day in our communities. It's the waitress that serves us tea in a restaurant. It's all the people we know by name who aren't going to heaven today. Now, these faces were going by my mind's eye. And I was reminded that the reason it's going by my mind's eye is because I'm in their life. God has brought me to them. And I don't know that I'm shining like I need to shine. Again, it was very gentle. There was no condemnation. There was no guilt. It was merely the opportunity to tell my story again to somebody. And I think we all have that experience. We have a glorious story to tell. You know, you have your testimony. No one has your testimony. You have that. And that testimony is a wonderful way to talk about what Jesus did for you. No one can argue with it. No one can deny it. No one can say it's not true. Because Jesus removed us from the cross. And I experienced it in a certain way, and you experienced it another way. So I want to pray for us that we will be the light of Jesus in our world that we live in. Now, we are ministers, and we think about a lost world, and we want to see our world come to Jesus. But I also want my family to go to heaven. I have neighbors. I want them to go to heaven. I have people I do business with. I want them to go to heaven. Don't you? So let's pray that the Lord would open those doors for us personally, that we can win people for Jesus. Wouldn't it be wonderful if ministers actually won people for Jesus too? And let's begin with who we know as we pray about a world that needs Jesus. Father, we stand before you today, and we come before you today, humble and broken, realizing the weight of our own inadequacy in comparison to the wonderful strength that you give us in forgiveness. Lord, this is one of those moments, perhaps it's something like Isaiah experienced as he experienced you in your fullness, and you asked him a question, who will go? It's so interesting, Lord, in that experience, who will go for us? And Isaiah was quick to answer, here I am, Lord, send me. And so, Lord, we have encountered you today. It's been glorious. It's been wonderful. I personally have been ministered to today with prophetic words and prayers for healing and strength. And Lord, I'm hearing you say, as you did with Isaiah, okay, so who will go? And I raise my hand today, Lord, and I say, here I am, send me. We raise our hands and we say, here we are, Lord, send us. And send us to the people we love the most. Open the doors to the hearts of our families, Lord. They're closed for so many reasons. Lord, I pray for our families that you will open the doors of their heart. Give opportunity. Let us say the right word at the right moment that opens something, conversation. We pray, Lord, for the hardships that they're going through, the victories they're having, that somehow, Lord, in the midst of that, you will speak to them. Lord, we pray for the deliverance of our homes, our families, our relationships. Lord, all of our neighbors, the communities we live in, the people we see every day, we call by name. The people we ride on the bus to work with, the people that we do business with in our jobs, Lord, all those people that we know, open the doors of their hearts to us, Lord. Let them, Lord, come to know you in a powerful way. Lord, we think about those people that we transact business with who we don't know their names, but they're familiar to us. They might be someone that serves us in a restaurant. They might be somebody that helps us with a task. Lord, you've brought them in relationship to us for a reason. Lord, open the doors of their heart so that something can be said that will open them to the gospel. Jesus, what would it profit a man if he gained the whole world and lose his soul? It's such a profound question, Lord. What would it profit us if we win the world to Jesus and our families go to hell? And so, Lord, I pray today that you will open the hearts of our families, our friends, and our relationships. And Lord, may we hear in this year great reports of harvest among those we love the most. I pray for the Scott family, that they will come to Jesus. I pray for my family, that they will come to Jesus. Thank you, Lord, that we can pray this prayer. Thank you, Lord, you will use us. Thank you, Lord, for the same power that saved us can save them. Do miracles, we pray. We'll give you praise, Jesus. In your name we pray.
Lord, hallelujah. Have we been blessed tonight? Amen?
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. We had a Holy Ghost meeting, amen, tonight. And we welcome, you know, if you had a word, just feel free to just write it down and maybe just slip it to me. And maybe we can read out some of the impression, the word, the visions that you've had, and that you'll be a blessing to the rest of the body. Just take a seat for just a few more minutes. Just to let us know if you did not receive Dr. Leslie Kegel's book on the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, in your welcome bag, there are some books that are still available outside. You can pick it up on the way out, so that you will be blessed by the experiences. This book that is full of testimonies, not just theoretical, scriptural, and as well as backed up by lots of wonderful things that have happened in the nation of Sri Lanka and many different parts of the world, how the Spirit of God is able to move through each and every one of our lives. Dr. Leslie has chronicled this wonderful journey that he has had, and I just want to encourage us to pick up this book and not just keep it in our library, but to read it again. To read it, all right? And then the other one more thing that we would just want to announce is some of us are not sure of what we mean by cultural mind, because maybe some of us are new, some of us have not come to ECFC before. One of the traditions of ECFC is we have the cultural night on the last night that we are together, and that is tomorrow night. And on the cultural night, what we do is every nation, so please make sure that you meet up with the representatives in your nation or your leaders and get together with them and to prepare a 3-minute presentation. That's all, a small 3-minute presentation. It can be a dance, it can be a skit, it can be some kind of music that comes from your culture. It doesn't have to be in English. It can be, you know, as we say, it's a celebration of the diversity that is represented here in the ECFC family. I know some of them have already gone back to their rooms, so please get a hold of people in your nations. And it's only a 3-minute presentation. So what we will do is tomorrow night when we come back after dinner, we will be having praise and worship. After praise and worship, the announcements, and then we will get into the cultural night. So each nation is given 3 minutes, no more than that, because we have 29 nations, and that is going to take almost 1.5 hours. But it's going to be lots of fun, all right? Okay, believe me, turn to your neighbor and say, it's going to be fun, right? It's going to be a lot of fun, and you're going to see all different cultures and all different groups coming up and presenting something that is unique from their own cultures and from their own nations. So make sure that you come in your cultural costumes so that we can take some really good pictures and at the same time celebrate and present. Well, you may not get what you come and you, as you come and see, you may think that, wow, we're going to get really professional presentations. As we have heard from Dr. Joyce tonight, we come with the heart of a pastor, all right? Not a party planner or one who's trying to perform, all right? We come with seeing the genuineness of the heart as we present. There will be some, mistakes here and there, and we may have some missteps, and it may not be all together coordinated, but that's the whole fun of the night. That's the whole fun of the night. So it's okay if the item, don't turn me off yet, guys. If the item is very simple and something that just just you want to do and just bless the rest of the family with. All right, so I was just told this by my team. I have an incredible team, as Pastor Joyce mentioned. They keep feeding me with lots of information and things that I need to remind. So what you see up here is not just one person, but it's a whole team that stands together with me. And I'm just the face. I'm just a pretty face behind the team, all right? Sorry, handsome. Handsome face behind. So praise the Lord. We've had a wonderful night. Why don't we stand and close this time in prayer? Thank you, Jesus. Lord Jesus, we just want to thank you. We want to thank you for the way that you have moved. Lord, thank you for the way that you have caused such a joy in our hearts, and the words that have come and that have ministered to us, for the altar calls, the worship,
in every part of this meeting tonight. Lord, we just ask you to continue to build the momentum, build what you're doing, Lord, layer upon our lives, Lord, so that by the time we get to the last morning, Father, before we leave, Lord, we will just be so filled, Lord, with your goodness, Lord, with your affirmation, Lord, upon our lives, Lord God, with a fresh mandate, Father, upon us as we depart and as we go back to our respective nations. Lord, we just pray and we want to commit each one of us into your hands. May we have a really good night's rest tonight and get up in the morning refreshed, ready, Lord God, to come and worship you and to hear what you have for each and every one of us. We pray and commit ourselves into your hands. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people say, Amen. Hallelujah. God bless you. See you at 8 a.m. sharp here tomorrow morning. Amen.
What do you want again? Sorry, I can't remember.
They have also the copy for tomorrow.